Thank you so much for joining us today for the message. As always, I want to encourage you to make sure that you are planted in a local church, wherever you live, so that you are able to serve and worship together with others. But we do pray that our church is a great resource to you and many others. And if our church has been a blessing to you, I would encourage you to join us in financially giving so that we can continue to provide resources just like today's message, as well as many other things abroad. Thank you again. God bless.
Let's make him feel comfortable. Good job. Thank y'all. Y'all must have had some coffee. I chose not to because I didn't want to rush into this subject and be like real hyper, because as a student pastor, you know I've preached a lot on marriage, right? Yeah, so this is another first. I think this is Josh's idea of like putting me through the gauntlet, you know, have me preach Leviticus, which I've never preached before, and then having me hit up a marriage sermon. Which, the good thing is, I'm married, and I've been married for almost 12 years now, so I got almost a dozen years under my belt. But the interesting thing, though, some of y'all might not know this, I actually won my wife over in middle school. Yeah, we started dating in my 7th grade summer. And y'all are like, you don't date in 7th. Oh, you do. You date. You talk to a middle schooler, they're dating. We were dating. I rolled up to her in the Lazy River at Watertown at a church retreat. Swam up, and I was like, you know, 75 pounds, soaking wet, little bitty thing. And she's little too, so, you know, I was like, this'll work. She's shorter than me, like the only person in the whole grade shorter than me. And so I swim up to her. I'm like, hey, you want to go out? Sure. And swam off. And that began the relationship, and that was in 2003, so we're approaching 20 years of being together. And so that is interesting. Some of y'all might be like, we're middle school sweethearts too. I haven't met very many of them, but yeah, we were middle school sweethearts, went through high school together, college together, and now have a couple of kids, Isabel and Abigail, and we have been enjoying marriage and all the ups and downs that come with it, and learning along the way, and taking advice from people who are way ahead of us in marriage. And I really believe that today our message will be something that is beneficial to all, and even those who are soon to be married or are pursuing marriage. So before we get into the message today, I want to first give a shout out to all the life groups that kicked off. That's exciting. We got a whole bunch of them going. Specifically, I want to say hello to the FCC Goes Camping Life Group, which is down in Lincoln Parish. So maybe they're saying hello back right now, so I'm just going to pretend we're all waving at each other. Rebecca and them have a group, and they go and they camp once a month, and they live stream the service all together. All the families come together, and they have church at the campsite. So they are in Lincoln Parish doing that this weekend. And I was like, yeah, you would plan a life group that gets you to go camping. That's like the coolest thing. And that's something that we want. We want life groups to be an opportunity for you as a potential member or a member of FCC to connect with a group and get to know them and really just have life together. And so definitely want you to check out all the ones we have available. It's never too late to jump in and join. And then also, since I'm here and I'm the student pastor, I'm excited to talk about Disciple Now for a brief moment. We have that coming up, and if you have a student, 6th grade through 12th, when I say they don't want to miss, I'm serious. They would not want to miss, and if they see what we do, they're going to be very bummed out if you did not sign them up. It is going to be a great weekend. We plan all kinds of fun, but most importantly, we have 4 different Bible studies, 3 different small groups, plus bringing them back on Sunday to hear a sermon, so they get 5 sessions of scripture that's pouring into them for the entire weekend, and that is the main reason that we have Disciple Now, is for that purpose. Now, do we put a lot of fun in there? Absolutely. Are there wild games? Yeah, because you want kids to want to come, so we make sure it is fun. If it's fun for adults, it's fun for the kids, so we're going to have a blast. If you're interested in volunteering or anything in that arena, you can go online and check out the sign-ups, and you can select which area you'd like to volunteer in. So that was my little plug for Disciple Now. And I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to get into the message today. And prayerfully, this will be a smooth sail, right? I know y'all have high expectations. I'm just messing. I'm excited about it, and I'm sure you are too. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this day. We just look forward to getting to open your word. God, to look at your commands of love. God, to look at your pursuit of us and how that should change our heart's desire and our pursuit for our spouse. God, I just pray that the gospel will be something that is mightily shown in our marriages. But first and foremost, God, I pray for our hearts. God, there are, you know, the different relationships in this room, but I guarantee there's many who are barely hanging on. God, there are some that are thinking about separating. God, there are people in this room that I know need to heed your message and your word. And God, I just pray that each person in this room that leaves here today will realize that this great and mighty gospel that we sing about and that we proclaim can transform our lives and our marriage, and it can cause us to rightly show you in the way that we live. So I just pray over this time that we read your word, and as we talk about this subject, God, guide me, and give me the words to speak. It's in Jesus' name, amen. We will be in Ephesians chapter 5. I know that you see that on your worship guide. So Ephesians chapter 5, 21 to 33. I want us to go there and begin reading, and then we will dive in to talk about some practical takeaways and then things that we can do within our own heart, as well as things that we can do with our spouse in order to grow and cultivate a marriage that is a continual pursuit and not just something that we exist in. And so that's where we're going to head. So let's start in verse 21. It says, submitting to one another in fear of Christ. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of the body. Let me go over to this translation here, my bad. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, so that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. Indeed, verse 29, no one ever hated his own body, but he nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. And for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This mystery is profound, but I'm speaking about Christ and the church. Nevertheless, each one of you should love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must see that she respects her husband. Now, there are several things in this passage that immediately stand out to me, and one of those is this comparison of the gospel and the church and our relationship with our spouse and how it is to mirror that relationship. And so when you think about the gospel and the different realities of it, the fact that we are given a unconditional love that is not dependent upon our performance, but merely upon God's sacrificial love for us, that we are in return to have that towards our spouse, an unconditional, sacrificial love that has the desire behind it to bring our spouse to a greater place, just like the gospel's desire is to bring us into a more Christ-like manner in this world. It is to prop us up for success in the kingdom of heaven, to live a life that reflects God's kingdom. And so when you think about our marriages, we have so many differences, right? You and your spouse, or soon to be spouse, you will be opposite in so many ways. And you have to learn as you grow to understand those things. But your goal within marriage, men, women, is the success of your spouse. You want to see them flourish. God wants to see us flourish. He wants us to grow. He wants us to better understand love and patience and kindness and gentleness. Like when we think about the fruit of the Spirit, we have to think about how can I see those fruits in my marriage? Am I displaying those things as I surrender to Christ? Or is this something that I merely say once a year on Valentine's Day or on a card for their birthday? Is it something that I'm daily seeking to do? And when you think about your personal walk with God, you know, Christ says that we have to daily deny what? Ourselves, right? In marriage, this is something that we also have to practice. And so every aspect of the gospel, it is wrapped up in marriage. You can see it, and that's what Paul talks about here. This display of marriage is a display of the gospel ultimately. And we as Christians are called to display it in a way that brings glory to God. And so we got to think to ourselves, you know, what is it within Scripture? Like, what is it calling me to? How am I to live? And that's why my first point was this. We have to understand the call in Scripture, our call in Scripture, to love sacrificially. Is that not the love we see of Christ all throughout the Bible? Is this picture of God sacrificially, even though His church, His bride, fails, He continues to pursue? I posted an article earlier this week, and it was talking about how within marriage, one of the things that happens so often, and I know, just like I talked about swimming up to her in the lazy river, there was a moment that we pursued that relationship. We saw that individual as someone who we desired, and so we pursued them to the point where we caught them, you know? Some of us would be like, yeah, no, she was a catch. And that's true. Or you might be saying, my husband was a catch. That's what my wife says all the time, you know? But, like, we come to that place where it's like we pursued them, we've now become one, and then we start to get to a place where we exist. And we're just living life, but we have to realize, and I know that y'all have realized this, as much as you change, you have to continue to pursue your wife. You have to continue to pursue your spouse because we have to learn each other and we have to grow in this. And so what I firmly believe has changed my marriage was something that we did a few years back. Our second child was born, Abigail. And the first child is, you know, just, there's something about when you have that first child, you're just in this la-la land almost for a while. And then the sleeplessness, and then all the other things that comes with having a newborn child. And you're having to completely relearn the relationship. Okay, how do we balance these things, right? And so we moved into a new stage. And then I, like a fool, was continuing to live as though I didn't just throw a child into the mix. I was still doing the same amount of youth things as I once did with a little baby at the house. And some of y'all are like probably going to start to judge me a little bit. But it's okay because I've repented from those things. We've moved on. I don't do that anymore. But during this time in the early part of having kids, I was coaching wrestling, doing different Bible studies, student ministry stuff, all these things. And I was all over the place. And my wife was working full-time as well. And so there became a strain within the marriage that was happening. And so there had to be a decision made once this second child came around. And I was still falling back into my usual routines. And I was neglecting my spouse in a way that caused her to feel as though she was third and fourth on the list to ministry and my hobbies. And some of y'all could honestly be in here today and would say, I kind of feel third and fourth on the list to my spouse. And a husband, you might say, you know what, I kind of feel that way as well. And so we sought out, and which I do not, you know, I'm not going to like share crazy amounts of details, but we did seek out a Christian, and I will say that, a strong Christian counselor recommended by my pastor, and we just had a few sessions with her. And she walked us through this understanding of who each other was, our makeup, and how we are to understand and love each other. And so we made a shift. We said, you know what? We are going to start dating again. And I know y'all were like, I've heard that before. But it was true. We set aside a day, and we were like, you know what? We are going to make this day a day that ministry's not going on, coaching's not going on. None of these things are happening. What is happening is we are just going to go, and we are going to have a meal together, and we are just going to talk. And so this began a practice that we did on a regular basis, and we saw the marriage go back to the pursuing that it was when we first got together. And so I really challenge you, like men, I know that you're able to set aside time for things. I know you are. We do that. Women, I know that you can meticulously plan some time to spend with your spouse without kids, without work, without all the distractions, and have a meal and just talk. I was listening to one of the pastors that I really like, and he was talking about him and his wife. They would do this on Mondays. And they would go about basically the state of the marriage address, you know, kind of like the president does. And they would ask, how are we doing? Like, what can I do differently? You know, tell me what it is on your list that brings love to you. Like, am I falling short in certain areas? Like, I want to love you better. And this has to be the desire for us because, like I said just a second ago, is this not a picture of Christ and his pursuit of us? He desires us to draw near to him, right? And we are to draw near to God. And it is this mutual coming together that creates a spiritual intimacy with God, just like we should be with our spouse. And so we have to read these scriptures and see that it's not just the wife's job or it's not just the husband's job. And even in the areas of intimacy, if you go and you look at where it talks about, you know, the wife is not over her body, the husband is. And then you're like, yeah. And then the next verse is like, likewise, husband, you are not over your body, but she is. And you're like, wait, what? And then it's this draw. We both equally come together in love and make decisions in regards to time, intimacy, and this marriage pursuit that we are going after. And so when we look at this, husbands, verse 25, love your wives just as. Like these are the words that keep popping out to me when I look at this passage. Husband, love your wife just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Love in Scripture is always sacrificial. It's not selfish. And when you think about all those weddings that you go to, love is kind, love is patient, right? Love doesn't envy, it doesn't boast, it doesn't parade itself around. It's not prideful, right? It's not arrogant. Christ's plan, his idea behind this relationship was not only to sanctify it, to cleanse it, but to present it one day as a reflection to the world of his relationship with us. So the better you love your wife as a Christian man, the better the world sees the gospel in you. Like, think of how crazy it would be if you were trying to have a conversation with somebody from work or another friend of yours about the gospel, but yet they see the way you treat and talk to your spouse or the way that you lead your family, and they're going to know that this gospel must not mean what you're trying to relay to me, because if it did, it would change you. And so there are several passages in Scripture, and for those of you who aren't married, those of you who are teenagers, or maybe you are I mean a widow or a widower, you are still called to love in a gospel manner to one another. Think about all the passages in Scripture that speak to us being a certain way to one another. For instance, Ephesians 4:32, he calls us to be kind to one another. Brothers, sisters, be kind to one another. Like, I know there's times that your sister probably gets under your skin. Yeah, and there's time your brother gets under your skin too. Oh, I know. My brothers messed with me all the time. But we have to learn to submit to the call of God to be kind. Man, there's times that we want to just let the flesh go, right? Real story. So how many of y'all have ever been to a skating rink for a birthday party? Raise your hand. Anybody? Okay, so I have a friend of mine that has a skating rink, and it's like, it has become the birthday party, center. It's the place everybody wants to go to have a birthday party now. But there's something that happens at those birthday parties when the public starts to come into play, and these teenagers start to skate, and you got these little 5 and 6 and 7 year olds on brownies trying to figure out how to skate, and these dudes just want to fly by. I mean, come right by them. Some of y'all, I know I can get some amens here in a second. There's a moment where you as a Christian want to say, all right, well, I just kind of want to mosey on over. And you're like, man, I can't do that. I'm a Christian. You know, I got to be Christ-like. As much as you want to shoulder some of those people that almost took out the little kids, you can't do that because we're called to be kind. We have to take our flesh and say, no, I'm supposed to be kind to one another. Galatians 5:13, serve one another. Colossians 3:13, forgive one another. Hebrews 3:13, encourage one another. Romans 12:10, honor one another. Romans 12:16, live in harmony with one another. James 5:16, pray for one another. Ephesians 5:21, submit to one another. There's all these scriptures of how we should treat one another, and when we're thinking about our spouse, that should be the ultimate one another for every Christian who is in a marriage. Your spouse is your greatest one another that you can treat. Matt Bradner said, husbands and wives, you are called to one another, your one and only. This is what you should do as a married man. It's not about, well, I have to, you know, try to be all, you know, soft. And no, you can love your wife and still be manly. You know, you can go and sit at a little restaurant that has pink glass chairs and drink from a pink cup of some sort of citrus tea. I did that this week. The tea was actually pretty good. I was surprised. There was no sugar in it, which I asked the lady for sugar, and she was like, basically, they don't have sugar in that place. It was really healthy. But the tea was good. She's like, I have natural honey in it. It's organic. I'm like, yeah, it's from a bee, but whatever. I don't know. Like, you do these things. Don't think that you're being, you know, weak. What are you doing? You're wanting the success of your spouse, right? You're wanting to invest into their love language. You're wanting to fill their glass. 1 John 4:7, it says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is what? What's it say? From God. We're going to do that one more time. 1 John 4, verse 7, it says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. So here's the second point. Our personal spiritual pursuits will transform our physical responses to our spouse. Our personal spiritual pursuits will transform our physical responses to our spouse. My wife is loved the most when I'm closest to God. I am able to have patience beyond what my natural self wants to have when I'm seeking the Lord on a daily basis. And on the flip side, if I have lacked in my spiritual time with the Lord, prayer, repentance, Bible reading, like if I've allowed myself to drift into just complacency in my Christian walk and my spiritual side feels just yuck when it comes to my relationship with God, likewise, my responses are more agitated with my children. They're not as sweet. I might have thoughts within my mind that are not loving whenever asked to do something that I usually just do like that. And I guarantee you, men, when you step up your spiritual game, your marriage will improve drastically. Guarantee it. There is no way you can draw close to God and not love others. That's 1 John 1. You can't say that you love God but hate your brother and sister, right? It says the love is not in you. But if we love God, if we seek God, His love builds up within us and we love others the way that He has loved us. So we will reflect in our physical response to our spouse the amount that we are pouring into our relationship with God. I firmly believe that because that relationship transforms us. Our Christian walk transforms us. So the closer we grow in our walk with God, the more we reflect His character in marriage. So if we want to be a better husband or a wife, it first begins within our own hearts. That's where it first begins. And you know as well as I do that when the Bible speaks about the heart, it's speaking about your mind and your total being. We know that the heart itself does not think, but the heart is the whole of man. It is who we are, and so if we want to improve, we start with who we are on the inside. John Piper said this. He said, the biggest investment that a wife or a husband can make to the spouse, the biggest investment, we talk about that often, right? It is an investment into their own souls. Our minds are sacred places. The first place we start is in that battlefield. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Proverbs 4, 23. Keep your heart with all vigilance. Keep your heart. Remember we said this is your mind. Keep it with vigilance. If you've allowed other things in this world to creep in, other people in this world to place thoughts within your mind that have caused you to see your spouse differently, or maybe it's caused you to think differently, just in general, you have to protect your mind from what goes into it. It could be the shows that you're watching. It could be the music that you're listening to. Teenagers, college age, like, all this trash music that is out there does nothing for your heart and soul. It only fosters wrong attitudes and practices within your life. You will never have success as a Christian if you are letting trash come in. And likewise, if we're listening as adults to constant negative or maybe watching things that are not fostering these God-like principles within our life, we're not going to see it. What you put in is what comes out all day long. So we have to protect our hearts. Let it be a sacred place. So in our personal spiritual pursuits, we have to guard it. Luke chapter 6, verse 45, it says, the good man brings good things out of the good treasure of his heart. If you're putting good within to your heart, within to your mind, within to your eyes and ears, like it is the gateway to your soul, you're protecting this, you're filling it. Then it says, for out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. Maybe the reason that you're not speaking lovingly towards your spouse is that you're not filling your head with the right stuff. Those unforgivable things in your mind need to become forgivable. Because we talked about the gospel being displayed in our marriage, the forgiveness of the gospel has to be displayed in our marriage too. The grace of the gospel has to be displayed in our marriage constantly. And so we let God's grace and mercy fill us so that we in return give that to our spouse. Third point is this. Our actions will reflect our affections for our spouse. Our actions are going to reflect this. So we understand our call in Scripture, so we begin to fill ourselves with the right things, the right thoughts. We guard and protect ourselves from the things that the world tries to say should be in a marriage or should be within intimacy. And we allow a better understanding of our spouse through different actions. Something that was said to me this week, love is always demonstrated, not just communicated. You can't just communicate it. You have to live it out. And I know that that is just another way of saying 1 John 3:18. Let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and truth. It's not just word and talk. We have to live this out actionably. And we know that this does not come easily. You can't just say, okay, today I'm going to be this way. It takes practice. It takes acknowledging, okay, we have gotten off path. And the way that you acknowledge that is by doing something called getting to know your spouse. And you say, well, I know my spouse. That's why I married her. Well, it's been a minute, okay? And everybody has changed. And the different seasons that we're in causes us to change. We grow, and the Scripture says we should grow together into one. The only way that you can stay one with somebody is if you are constantly pursuing them. So it's not a pursue, catch, exist. It's pursue, catch, and then you continue to pursue the rest of your life. And you will mess up, and you will pursue, and you will love, and you will forgive, and you will continue this on. So you have to pay attention. Here's some practical things. This is some stuff that Josh shared in a message a while back. I'm not sure exactly when it was, but these are some questions. We pay attention. We ask ourselves, what does our spouse love to do? What is it that brings them enjoyment? What is meaningful to your spouse? What is their idea of an ideal day? A night alone, a weekend, a vacation. For mine, I'm going to go ahead and tell you, it's a clean house. If that house is clean and that laundry is done, I could have bought her the biggest diamond that there was that her mother sells, you know? Her mom sells jewelry. But like, I could have done all that housework and nothing tops that. Because for her and her, you know, love language, it is for sure acts of service, but it's a clean house. I mean, it just brings, she's just at peace. And when the wife is at peace, everybody's at peace. I know people make jokes, if the wife ain't happy, nobody's happy, or happy wife, happy life. I know it goes both ways, but I'm just saying from a man's perspective, we are a whole lot happier when our mama's happy. You know, that's just how it is. So we have to ask our spouse, like, what's the ideal day? And you shouldn't have to ask this. Just pay attention. You should know this. Maybe you need to remind yourself of these things. Like, oh, yeah, my wife does like when I did that back in 1992. Maybe I should do that again, you know? I don't know. Whenever the last time it was that you said, you know what, I'm going to overly love her and the way that she wants to be loved. What makes them sad? What makes them angry? What makes them irritated? And I'm not going to give you everything on my relationship, but I'm just giving you some. What gives them the greatest joy and reward? Quality time. I know many people have that high on their list. They want to have quality time with the person that they're in the relationship with, where they feel like they're present, and where they feel like they want to be there. What would they like to do in the future? James 1:19 tells us, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. So when we go back to Ephesians 5 and we look at verse 28, he was talking about Christ and the church and this relationship and how the marriage should reflect it. It's a picture of the gospel. And then he says, in the same way, husbands are to love their wives as their own body. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one has ever hated his own body, but he nourishes and cherishes it. And so you think about this. If you were to ask your spouse, answer this question for me. I feel most loved when? Fill in the blank. If you're like, hey, when do you feel most loved by me? And I was putting this in the slide last night, and I asked Summer, I said, when do you feel most loved by me? And I kid you not, this was her answer. She said, well, when I lay in bed and I know I don't want to get back out of this bed, and you've already gotten in bed, and I say, can you go get me a drink? How many of y'all have been there? Anybody? Am I the only person that it seems like the moment you hit that bed, your wife needs something? Anybody? Yeah, okay. Some of y'all are being honest. And then she's like, and you just do it. And you don't say anything, and you don't complain. You just say, sure. And then I was like, I said, well, to be honest, on the inside of me, there are some thoughts. But my love for you outweighs those thoughts. And I told her, the more we have grown together as a couple, the higher that love has gotten, and the lower those frustrations are that I need gas in my car and it's 10 o'clock at night, you know, and she's got a 55-minute drive to work. And I'm like, you know, yeah, let me go put my pajamas back on and go to the gas station down the street. It's okay to spoil your spouse. Women do it too. Like, it's not just our job. Like, y'all do it also. And we know that y'all do. And we recognize it and we see it. But ask them, what makes you feel the most loved? If you're dating somebody right now, like, you need to figure this stuff out. Figure it out on the front end. Like, I knew when we started dating and I started driving that all my money was about to go bye-bye, because I knew that my wife liked sushi. And so guess what? Guess what I was doing to show love to her? Getting her sushi on a regular basis. Still to this day, we eat a lot of sushi. But we were going out and having sushi. All my mowing money, gone. I had a sit-down one time. I'm not kidding you. Like, my dad and my brothers were going through my bank account when I was in high school because I had a lawn business. And they were like, this is ridiculous, blah, blah, blah. And they were just chewing me out. And I'm just like, it's my money. I'll blow it on her if I want to. But you know what? Like, we loved each other. We were getting to know each other. And I was doing everything I could to meet those areas that made her feel loved. Your marriage will not be successful if you strictly live for yourself. But there is this joy that comes when you bless somebody else. I mean, think about the scriptures. How more blessed it is to give than to receive. We love to get to see the enjoyment of somebody receiving something that we've done for them. That sense of accomplishment. So just know this, wherever you're at right now, if you're a Christian and if you're in Christ, in that relationship, your marriage can be saved. No doubt. As much as your relationship with God, no matter what, can be saved, so can your marriage. Let the gospel infiltrate those areas that seem so dark and seem so distant, and let it change it. It's going to start on the inside of you. Emotionally, it's going to take work. This is the physical side of things. But you have to pray for it daily so that the spiritual working of the Holy Spirit can get in there and restore that love that you had when you first pursued your spouse. Keep pursuing. Your life should be pursue, catch, pursue from here on out. Your lifestyle wins and loses the battle every day. The lifestyle that you choose. Another person says, the systems that you put in place will be the rise or fall of whatever it is you're going after. And so if you know that your spouse is to be loved a certain way, and you want that marriage to succeed, and you want to be loved in the way that you want to be loved, fill their love bank, and they will fill yours. It is a mutual thing. Just like the relationship with God, we draw close to God, He draws close to us. And let our marriages reflect that gospel and reflect that relationship with our Father. So my prayer is that you do those things. You protect your mind. You invest in your personal spiritual holiness and begin to seek your spouse every day to have a marriage that just absolutely displays the glory of God and the gospel. Trent's going to make his way up, and I'm going to close us out in prayer. God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to get to read your word. God, I know that in all of our lives, we have different seasons. God, you speak about this in your word. There's a time for rejoicing. There's a time for mourning. There's a time for happiness, sadness, all these things. We go through these things in life, and God, I thank you that you have given us the gift of marriage. God, that you have given us an opportunity to physically see that spiritual relationship that you have with us. God, that we get to better know each other as we grow to better know you. God, I pray that we never sever our relationship with you from that relationship with our spouse, but God, that we intermingle those things so that we are constantly growing together as one. God, I pray for those that are in here who aren't married. God, the ones who might be single. God, or the ones who have lost their spouse. All of these things are still true for us, God. And I just pray that you will encourage them today to continue to love everybody in this way. That in their singleness and in their stage of life, God, that they can reflect your word. Help us to be reflections and help us to guard our minds against the enemy that's in this world trying to separate us. God, give us grace, give us mercy for one another. And I just pray for the marriages in this room that are going to kickstart a new pursuit for each other. God, I pray that as weird as it may be at first, God, that eventually it will become something that they absolutely enjoy doing and they get to see the fruit of it. So God, we just pray your word over them today, and we just ask that you will bless each and every one of these relationships in this room. And we just lift this up in your name. Amen.